Okay, so this webinar is on AutoML, which is like the quest for using machine learning and optimization in order to make machine learning better, in order to make machine learning more robust and easier to use for people without expert knowledge in machine learning. In the title, you can also read hyperparameter optimization and not just AutoML, because hyperparameter optimization is the basic building block for AutoML. AutoML goes further by trying to automate the entire machine learning pipeline. So you'll see this during this presentation. Just as a precondition to be able to follow this webinar, I assume that you have some knowledge of machine learning or even deep learning. So for example, when I talk about training data, test data, neurons and architecture, this term should be familiar to you. Okay, so to briefly give some motivation, we live in very exciting times, of course, for machine learning and deep learning. We have seen tremendous progress in speech recognition and computer vision for self-driving cars, in reasoning and games, and deep reinforcement learning, etc. But all these advances are based on expert knowledge of some very brilliant people who have gathered a lot of expertise in deep learning and machine learning and know how to set all the hyperparameters. So if you want to apply machine learning or deep learning to a new problem domain, that is, of course, deep learning is very sensitive to a lot of different hyperparameters, such as architectural choices and the choices in the optimization pipeline and the way you regularize your network in order to generalize to a new unseen data. And so it's you easily get between 20 to 50 design decisions that you need to make in order to start to train your model. Or your network. And that leads to the current state of deep learning practice. So given a new data set, you need an expert that chooses the architecture and the hyperparameters that would work well for this data. And then given that architecture and hyperparameters, you can apply deep learning, for example, in an end-to-end fashion to learn features from the raw data. But unfortunately, even experts don't always exactly know how to choose the architecture and the hyperparameters. So you end up with this iterative loop with the human in the loop. The human expert having to choose architectures and different hyperparameters, exploring that space in order to, at the end, actually get a nice deep learning system that gets state-of-the-art performance. So what AutoML tries to do is to provide this kind of one put shot. So you put in the data, and there is this big box here that does end-to-end learning. So that does learn features from raw data, but also already decides about which architectures to use and which hyperparameter to use, etc. And one way to achieve this is, of course, to mimic this manual approach up here, where you have some deep neural network. So you can have some learning box that could just be a deep learning framework, and you have the expert choosing architecture and hyperparameters here. So you replace that by a meta-level learning and optimization process that reasons about which architectures work well and which hyperparameters work well on this particular data. And you can also reason across different data sets. This learning box is not constrained to be a deep neural network. It can also be some traditional machine learning pipeline. So for example, you need to clean and pre-process your data. Select better features, select the model family and the type of hyperparameter, and construct an ensemble of this model. And you can also do meta-reasoning on which hyperparameters work well in this framework. So the outline of the webinar is as follows. We'll first give a definition of what is hyperparameter optimization and AutoML. And we will also we'll talk about modern approach to hyperparameter optimization, which sounds as somewhat a boring topic. But if you don't get automated hyperparameter optimization inside of your inner loop, then you cannot really do AutoML. So it's really important to have a robust and efficient core of your machine learning pipeline. So let's define the hyperparameter optimization problem we are talking about. So we have some algorithm, some machine learning algorithm A, and it has hyperparameters lambda with domain capital lambda. And so we'll use lambda throughout the webinar for hyperparameter. And you have a loss that depends on your algorithm that is configured with the hyperparameters. The algorithm is trained on trained data and validated on validation data. And the hyperparameter optimization problem is just to find the hyperparameter setting that minimizes this loss, so the validation loss. All right, what are these hyperparameters? Well, so there is continuous hyperparameters, of course, such as learning rate in a neural network. There is also integer hyperparameters, such as the number of units or the number of trees in a random forest. And there's also categorical hyperparameters that are maybe a bit more interesting than continuous one and the integer one. So these categorical parameters are discrete, so we cannot differentiate for them. They finite and unordered. So some example here, maybe well, so you may just choose between different algorithms, machine learning algorithms, like super vector machine, random forest, or neural network. Or you might choose activation function and for your neural network, like ReLU, LeQ-ReLU, or 10H. And you might also choose operators that operate on your latent feature representation, such as convolution and max pruning. A special case, of course, of categorical hyperparameters are binary hyperparameters. Another type of hyperparameters is conditional hyperparameters. And so conditional hyperparameters B are only active if some other hyperparameters A are set in a certain way. And these conditional hyperparameters allow us to write pretty generic search space as a hyperparameter optimization problem. So one example is the Adam's second momentum parameter. So if you don't use Adam, then this hyperparameter is not going to be active. It's not even going to be inspected, and it's probably unimportant. If you don't pick Adam, then you don't need to pick the second momentum hyperparameter. Likewise, if you have a parameter that is the convolution kernel size of a certain layer of your deep neural network, if the type of that layer is not a convolution, then this hyperparameter is not going to be active. And as a final example, if you have a super vector machine kernel, you only need to choose that if you actually use a super vector machine as an algorithm. If you use, for example, a random forest instead, then probably that SVM kernel hyperparameter is not going to be inspected. So with this notion of conditional hyperparameters, we can actually write AutoML as a hyperparameter optimization problem, so as follows. So there is this combined algorithm selection and hyperparameter optimization problem, okay, that we call cache problem, where you have several algorithms, and each of these have hyperparameter space. and you can have a loss function. And now the problem is to find the combination of the best algorithm and its hyperparameters to jointly minimize this loss. And with that, you can actually write this combined algorithm selection hyperparameter optimization problem as just an hyperparameter optimization problem, where you have one top level hyperparameters that is the choice of the algorithm. And all the other hyperparameters are conditional on that choice. Okay. So I hope to have persuaded you that hyperparameter optimization with the general notion of what constitutes hyperparameters is a powerful solution. So let's talk about some black box optimization method for doing hyperparameters optimization. So we see grid search, random search, and in more detail, Bayesian optimization. So, so if you have, for example, so what is black box optimization? So if you have, for example, a deep neural network, and you have different hyperparameter settings here, and you have a box that trains this deep neural network and validates it, then you get on, then you get out validation performance. Well, what black box optimization does is treat this as a black box and seek for the input lambda that minimizes the validation accuracy or the validation performance. So you just search for the lambda that maximizes f of lambda. And with that, you throw away all information about what happened inside of that black box. And when you give up a lot by doing that, but it gives you a generic interface for applying this to all kinds of different problems. This black box function is of course expensive to evaluate, so sample efficiency is important, and we can't evaluate this black box often. Okay, so the arguably simplest approach for doing hyperparameter optimization is grid search. So you just define a grid over your hyperparameter space and you evaluate all the points in this grid, and then you pick up the best one. It's like a brute force method. So the main advantage of grid search is its simplicity, since it evaluates all possible combinations. If the optimal value is in the grid, it is guaranteed to be found. However, the downside is that it can be very computationally expensive, especially with a large number of hyperparameters or when the datasets are large. This is of course exponential in the number of hyperparameters, and so it's useful for if you have one or two hyperparameters, but if you have a lot of hyperparameters, it's probably not the best method. Random search is a technique for hyperparameter optimization that differs from grid search by randomly selecting combination of hyperparameters to evaluate. So it optimizes hyperparameters by randomly exploring the hyperparameter search space, which can lead to faster and sometimes better results than grid search, especially when you only have a few hyperparameters. That significantly impacts the model's performance. So random search is only exponential in the number of important hyperparameters. And as you can see in this illustration, if you have, for example, one important hyperparameter here, and you have one important hyperparameter, then what random search does with this budget of 9 function, so we have 9 function here, that evaluates, random search evaluates this 9 function, and you get 9 different values for this important hyperparameters. And therefore you can just, you can use your budget much more efficiently than grid search, which would only get three values for this important IPAR parameter, and get each of these evaluation three times because an important IPAR parameter doesn't matter. So random shard definitely does perform better than grid search if you have some inimportant parameter, IPAR parameters. And often, oftentimes, you have IPAR parameters that are not completely unimportant, but you definitely have some IPAR parameters that are far more important than others, such as learning height in a neural network. And so, random search is a useful baseline because of that, but it does have the problem that it doesn't follow the information. So it doesn't actually learn anything from the search space. Like if one part of the space performance is dramatically better than in the other parts of the space, so random search will just not care about that. And that is not optimal. So one approach that does care about this is Bayesian optimization, which is a very popular approach for black box function optimization. So the key idea is that if we cannot observe this kind of like black box, so let's try to model it. Yeah. So let's try to model the relationship between the hyperparameters that we pass in and the things that we observe, such as like the cross validation error or the performance accuracy. So we are going to try to model the black box. So we are going to use a probabilistic model to describe that functional relationship here. So we approximate the black box using a probabilistic model, and we use the outcomes of past experiences as training data. So we can query the black box. We observe something, we query again the black box, we observe something else, and we can use this as training data for a supervised learning problem. This kind of like proxy model is much cheaper to evaluate than the original objective function. So imagine again that you have to wait for 2 weeks for an outcome of your experiment, for example. If you have to train a really big neural network and then run cross-validation rate. But if you have a proxy model, we can just evaluate the function of relationship without actually training or using the deep network to get the true observed function value. So now if we had now this approximate model, if that model that is relatively cheap to evaluate, because we just wait for like a few milliseconds or seconds to evaluate this function, if that is very close to the true objective function, then we can just say, why don't we just optimize this approximate function, this proxy function, and we just find the optimal parameter for our deep network, for our machine learning algorithm. It's about finding optimal parameter of our expansive function by not using the expansive function. And the standard proxy model that is being used in the Bayesian optimization is the Gaussian process. So right, here are the key steps of Bayesian optimization. So to avoid evaluating this expansive function f that we have an excessive number of times, we approximate f using our surrogate function or proxy function f tilde, which is simpler to evaluate. Then we find a global optimum of f tilde of lambda star. So lambda star is the optimal hyperparameter of our proxy function. So we find a global optimum of f tilde of lambda star of this proxy function. And then we take this lambda star value that we can found by optimizing f tilde now to evaluate the true objective function at this point. If we were to optimize f directly, and let's say we would run gradient descent, we have to evaluate f many, many times to actually get a local optimum. And we will need to have gradients also. Whereas here, we take the kind of like the optimization away from f, and use f tilde to run this optimization. So we can run, we can evaluate f tilde many times, and once we found an optimizer lambda star of f tilde, we can now evaluate the true objective function at lambda star. So all of this require evaluating f a single time, which is in this third bullet here. So we are going to repeat this with a more details a bit later, but this is the high level idea of how Bayesian optimization works for hyperparameter optimization. So this works well if f tilde is approximately equal to f, because then we would just have a cheap version of f, and then normally we would need to repeat this cycle, because without any data or with very little data of f tilde we cannot be similar to f. And once we have now evaluate f, then we obey the model, the f tilde, the proxy model, and then over time it becomes better. Okay. So maybe I will give you a picture illustration of how this works. So imagine that our true objective function, like the black box function, the true objective function, is this blue line. Yeah. So we want to find the global optimum. So at the x axis we have like the hyperparameter, and here we have like at the y axis we have our cross validation, or our performance, our accuracy. And we want to find like the global optimum, like the value of hyperparameters we want to find like the global optimum of gv theta. So it's somewhere here. So this is the loss function. I want to find like the global optimum of this loss function. So we don't know like the true objective function. It's our black box function. And now we have one observation of what G is at this particular point here. And we are going to fit a Gaussian process to this worst one training point. So the Gaussian process with one training point is illustrated here. So you have the posterior mean function is the black line, and the shaded area corresponds to the uncertainty. What we are going to optimize now, or what we are going to use now, is we are going to look not only at the global minimum of the mean function, but we are going to look at the minimum of the mean function minus 2 times the standard deviation, and that will correspond to the minimum of like this red line, gray shaded area. That is the function that we optimize. So basically, the function we want to optimize look like goes up here, and let's say that this mountain here, and then goes back down. So we want to find the minimum of this, and the minimum is now here at theta equal minus 5. So that's what the Gaussian process tells us. That is the minimum of the shaded area. So this now where we evaluate the true blue function next. So now what we use our black box function to evaluate our model. And so now we are going to evaluate the blue function next. And at this point, so that's now the observation that we have, and we update our Gaussian process. Now we're going to go back again and say, okay, where is the minimum of the shaded area? And now the minimum of the shaded area is at theta equal 5. And we're going to evaluate the blue function again at theta equal 5 and update the Gaussian process. And then we kind of like repeat this like this. We are going to look again at the minimum of the shaded area, which is now here. So this is what the Gaussian process tells us. And evaluate the blue function of the expansive function where the minimum of the proxy is. So now we keep doing this, and you can see that after a few iterations, the Gaussian process is relatively a good approximation to the blue function. So that already look relatively good, and so we keep doing this now. And okay, so now we are basically at the point where we say, okay, we just keep repeating evaluating at the same point. So we can say that we found the global optimum of the blue function by evaluating the blue function only like few times, let's say 10 times. And so the Gaussian process model is not great everywhere, but in this area over here on the right hand side, like here, we are not really interested, or we are not really interested in having a high quality approximation, because the function value are just too bad. And so we are interested in minimizing J of theta. And so that means we need to have relatively good approximation of J of theta, where J of theta is small. Okay. Where J of theta has high value, like here. So we don't need a good approximation of the proxy model. So that's the idea of how Bayesian optimization with Gaussian process works for doing the hyperparameter optimization. Okay. So now we are going to look at how to choose the next point to evaluate the trop-objective function. So where do we find this lambda star, or this theta value from? So if we look at the proxy in our case, Gaussian process, and what we are going to look is something called an acquisition function. So the acquisition function tells us where to evaluate the true objective, the true function next. And so here's again one of the settings that we are looking at. So we just saw this. So we are interested in finding the global optimum of the true objective function, and we need to use the Gaussian process that also gets out of local optimum. So what we are going to do here is we need to be able to extrapolate from like knowledge that we have already collected, which is represented by this point, in something that we have. So it's something that we have seen before, and the Gaussian process allow us to exactly do this, because like the Gaussian process give us closed form expression for means and variance. So we can use this to trade off like exploration and exploitation. So what exploration means, so we are looking for places where the Gaussian process has high variance or high uncertainty. For example, in this picture, that will be somewhere here on the right hand side, and maybe also somewhere here where we don't have much data. But we also need to we can also exploit what we already know. So if we are interested in minimizing our true objective function that we have already evaluated at a few points, then the posterior mean is an indicator where we can look at. So if you look at places with low posterior mean, then we can explore that knowledge, ignoring all uncertainty that comes with the Gaussian process. So if we just look at the mean, we can exploit the knowledge of places where the mean is low. So it's an indicator where the true function is also low. So these kind of things, like so exploration, like look at places with high uncertainty, and exploitation, look at places to have low mean. It's something that we need to trade off. And so it's exactly where this acquisition function came into places. So so acquisition function, we are going to denote them as by alpha, and they trade off exploration and exploitation for our proxy model. Here's how this entire thing now works, or Bayesian optimization works. So like it's the same setting as before. Like so we have initial data set of evaluation of the true objective function and like the corresponding which is the corresponding input of IPA parameters. And then using this data, we update our Gaussian process. We train our Gaussian process. Then we select the next point or the next parameters by optimizing this acquisition function. So we have an acquisition function that we have to optimize to select that next spot to evaluate. And then after that, it's like the same setting. We query the objective function. We retrieve like the true value of the acquisition function. We update our data and we reuse again the Gaussian process. We update our Gaussian process. We reuse again the acquisition function to like find where we should use the true objective function. We create the acquisition function and again and again and until like a stupid criteria. Okay, so there are several type of acquisition functions. Each has its strategy that balance exploration and exploitation. So I'm not going to into much more detail about acquisition function, just to know that there is three type of acquisition function that exist. So we have probability of improvement that measure the probability that a new sample will yield an improvement over the current best. So it's focusing only on the probability rather than the magnitude of improvement. Expected improvement, so it's not considered just the probability, but also the expected magnitude of improvement. And we have a Gaussian process upper confidence bound, so it creates a balance between mean and uncertainty. So with a tunable parameter that you can adjust the level of exploration and exploitation. Okay, so using the Gaussian process to mimic the true objective function is a powerful method, but they have some limits. So if the space is high dimensional, the Gaussian process is not effective. If we have mixed continuous and discrete parameters, and if we have conditional parameters, so the Gaussian process is not the best approach if we have this like criteria in your search. There is some improvement in the literature. For example, SMAC, that instead of using a Gaussian process, they use a random forest as like the proxy model to represent the uncertainty and to search for the best hyperparameters. So I'm not going to into much detail about this, but just note that there is some improvement for using like Bayesian optimization. And let's shift our focus now to the practical side of hyperparameter optimization. So today we have access to a suite of sophisticated tools that can streamline this process. Whether you are novice or an expert, these tools can significantly enhance like your machine learning workflow. So first we have scikit-learn, like a versatile library that became essential in the machine learning community. It offers tools like grid search cross-validation and random search cross-validation for hyperparameter tuning. So it's making it a go-to for many practitioners. So we can find this its rich documentation and resources at scikit-learn.org. For those interested in more advanced techniques, like hyper-OPT is an excellent choice. So personally, I use hyper-OPT and Optima. So hyper-OPT enables the optimization of our complex search pairs, and it's particularly adept at navigating high-dimensional space. There is also Optina, an open source framework that's specifically designed for hyperparameter optimization. It's like it's friendly, it's user friendly. Like you can stock your research process in a database. It's highly flexible and There is a good documentation in your website. You have SMAC, the SMAC tool, which stands for Sequential Model Based Algorithm Configuration. So it's not only for machine learning, it's also for all type of algorithm. So that it combines random search with the model based optimization, so Bayesian optimization, using random forest. It's a powerful approach, and it's specially for complex model, and its code base is hosted on GitHub. And lastly, for more focused application of Bayesian optimization, like there is a Bayesian optimization library with a straightforward interface available in GitHub also. So personally, I use HyperOPT and Optional. Okay, so in summary, hyperparameter optimization and automated machine learning are game changers. They elevate model accuracy and make machine learning more accessible. And these tools save time and machine learning solution and make machine learning solution more robust. Okay, so that's it. I don't know if you have a question.
Thank you so much. For this webinar, I just want to remind everyone that it is the first webinar of the AI Touch project, and we'll have other two that will follow. So I see that on the chat we have one question. So how do you see HPO as one-shot task and/or as a sort of continuous or periodic task?
Okay.
Can you kindly reply?
Okay. So like, what I mean by one-shot task, like just doing one time before like deploying your machine learning solution, or I guess it depends on the use case. It can be continuous task if like you have an evolving environment, but if like you have just like one shot use case, then it can be like a one shot solution. But for me, it's more of a continuous and periodic task. A continuous task. So one time before deployment. Okay, yes. If you deploy your machine learning one time, so I think that only using hyperparameter optimization one time is okay. But like if you have to like monitor and manage your machine learning solution, then hyperparameter optimization have to be performed continuously. Okay, so we have also which tool for AutoML would you recommend us? So SMAC is AutoML tools. Like as I said, like you can do like AutoML with Optunia or with HyperOPT or with other with all of these tools. Just like you have to consider like as I said here, you have to consider your machine learning algorithm as hyperparameters. If you consider your machine learning algorithm as hyperparameters, then you can just apply an hyperparameter solution for doing AutoML. But there is also another tool like AutoScalian, which perform all the pipeline for all the, which is like automate all the pipeline, like cleaning, selecting, and generating. But I tried this and like for that for my for like well-known data set like for imagery and something like this, it perform more well. But if you give like specific data set about networking and something like this, it's not going to perform well. Like we have some specific usage in networking, and like library like this that doesn't work well for us in our domain. Okay.
I don't see other question coming. So I think we can thank you all for attending this webinar, and thank you, Omar, for your presentation. Okay. And this registration will be available soon on the YouTube page of the project. So if you want to go back and listen to it again, you will see it there. So thank you all. And I wish you all a good day.